The monthly program of the Historical Society of Berks County. I'm your host, George M. Meiser IX, president of the Historical Society of Berks County and publisher of the Historical Review of Berks County, the Society's quarterly magazine in print continuously since October of 1935. Not incidentally, most back issues of the review are available from the late 1930s to the present time. It should be noted that this program is telecast live on the first Wednesday of each month at 7. It repeats this Friday at 10, Saturday at 6, and Sunday morning at 9 a.m. Welcome all to our July the 2nd, 2008 program. Seated beside me is my co-host, Gloria Jean Meiser. Beside her is Sime Berlitz, the Society's Executive Director.
Good evening.
And beside Sime is Amy Walter Johnson, the City of Reading's Historical Preservation Specialist.
Good evening.
We thank you all for being with us this evening.
The Society's Museum, Library, Gift Shop, and Exhibition Hall are open Tuesday through Saturday from 9 to 4. The shop is fully stocked with Reading and Berks histories by a variety of present-day and old-time authors. A number of unusual pottery pieces by Lester Brininger, and pottery items by other local potters are now in stock. Remember, the Historical Society's gift shop has a large inventory of Reading and Berks County history, new and pre-owned.
I believe, are those in the gift shop too, Gloria?
Yes, these are selling in our gift shop.
Oh, how handsome. Maybe Mr. Berlitz will tell us more about those in due course or now.
Well, we could say something about those now. Those are commemorative keepsake baseball cap that we have had commissioned for the Historical Society, and they celebrate the current exhibit, the 175th anniversary of the Reading Railroad. As you might know, the Norfolk Southern Corporation was our major underwriter for that exhibit, and we have had these caps made up. They come in four colors. You have khaki, you have red, navy blue, and white, and they sell for $10 a piece in the gift shop. All the proceeds go to the Historical Society of Berks County, and I think they make a great gift item for maybe, we got Christmases coming up, or birthdays or something like that, or just to say that you have something from the 175th anniversary of the Reading Railroad. So they're available in the gift shop. Get them while they last. There are not that many of them.
And, of course, they do tie in with our current exhibit at the in Exhibition Hall at the Historical Society, curated by Ben Bernhardt. And our Joshua Blay, the curator and associate director of the Historical Society. How much are they, Sime?
$10.
$10, and they're available at the Historical Society, commemoratively prepared for the 175th anniversary of the Reading Company. Gloria Jean, special note, I believe.
That's correct. In proper observance of our nation's Independence Day, the Society will be closed Friday, July 4th, and Saturday, July 5th. We will reopen the Society on Tuesday, July 8th at 9 a.m.
We remind viewers that for $30 a year, you can be one of us, a member of the Historical Society of Berks County. Membership in the Society includes our prize-winning quarterly magazine, The Historical Review of Berks County. Michelle Lynch, a longtime member of the Historical Society and someone who preceded Amy as a historic preservation specialist at City Hall, is the editor of that magazine. Membership includes unlimited use of the museum and library. And I should comment that we're up to about 18,000 photographs in the library collection at the Historical Society. And as a member, you can come in from time to time or every day if you're a member and page through the finding guides with samples of all those pictures. It's a great way to spend an afternoon. Incidentally, family memberships, all living in the same house, are only $40 a year.
And while we're on the subject of memberships, We remind you that Berks Community Television, now observing its 31st anniversary, is a survivor in a trust venue and a unique entity in that it's interactive. You are encouraged to call in with questions and comments.
Why not salute BCTV for all the great shows it provides to Reading and Berks and send a check for $30 for a year's membership? Mail your check to BCTV, that's Berks Community TV, 645 Penn Street, Reading, Pennsylvania, 19601. Remember, time passes, but operating expenses never go away.
We're pleased again to welcome Amy Wolf Johnson to the program. Amy is a member of the Historical Society and the City of Reading's Historical Preservation Specialist, who returns to provide information on an upcoming historical architectural competition of sorts. She has with her photos of some of her last year's winning properties so that home viewers have a better idea what the competition is all about.
Amy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the third year in a row, we are produced by the Downtown Improvement District Authority, or DIB, holding the Beautiful Buildings of Downtown contest. And the purpose of the contest is to acknowledge property owners whose buildings have an exemplary positive impact on their neighborhood. And the contest is running now until August 13th, which is the deadline for entries. If I could have the map, I can give you the boundaries of the contest. The boundaries for the contest include, of course, the downtown area from the Schuylkill River to City Park, and from Elm Street to Chestnut Street on the south, and north and south, as well as it includes the Penns Common Historic District, which is the orange area on the map, and the Callow Hill Historic District, which is the blue area on the map. The categories for the contest include Category 1 is a private residence. Category 2 is a commercial business or apartment building with 5 or more units. Category 3 is a public building or institution such as a school or church. And Category 4, which is an honorable mention category, is for the most improved building. Prizes are for categories 1 through 3. Winners will receive a custom designed brass plaque designed by Crescent Brass, and a gift certificate from Lowe's for $50 and from Home Depot for $25. And the honorable mention category will receive a $50 gift certificate to Hong Kong Restaurant. Nomination forms can be obtained in City Hall, in the Mayor's office, or in my office in the Planning and Zoning office, which is room 3-03 in City Hall. And at any midday cafe, the DID office at 645 Penn Street, the Reading Public Library at 100 South 5th Street, and at the DID website, which is www.downtownreading.com. And voting is free, and we ask that people cast only one vote per person. Ballots can be dropped off at any midday cafe as well, or mailed or delivered to the DID office, again at 645 Penn Street on the second floor. The committee members and judges include the prestigious George Mizer, the Honorable Thomas McMahon, Mayor of the City of Reading, Douglas Kramer, Principal of Synergetics Architects, myself, and John Hill, who is Principal of Muhlenberg Green Architects Limited, and Lori Swan, who is the Acting Executive Director for the Reading DID, as well as Deborah Miller, who is the Events Director for the DID. The award ceremony will be held at 12:15 p.m. on Wednesday, September 3rd at the Rock, Roll, and Reading Public Library Midday Cafe, which will be held in Courtyard 1 at 6th and 10th Street behind Sovereign Bank. And I'd like to, of course, thank our sponsors for the contest, who are McCarthy Engineering, Crescent Brass, the law firm of Mogul, Fidel, Bob, and Kirshner, Muhlenberg Green Architects Limited, and the City of Reading. And if I could have the photographs up, I can show you last year's winners. This is the first, under the first category, private residence. This is 204 North 5th Street. And I can tell you that it was a multiple-unit apartment building, and the owners turned it back into a single-family residence. And they just did a, it's a brownstone building, but they did a beautiful job restoring the woodwork, and just an exemplary building in the neighborhood.
Very handsome inside and out.
Yes, yes it is. The second winner under the second category for the commercial or business is the Y Missing Club, or the senior apartments at the Y Missing Club. And this is located at 501 Walnut Street. And it underwent an entire rehab, I believe it was 1999 or 2000. But it's a beautiful corner property there, 5th and Walnut Street. The next building under the third category for a public building or institution is Trinity Lutheran Church, and it's located at 527 Washington Street. And the fourth winner for most improved building is the Goggle Works Center for the Arts, which of course is the adaptive reuse project and is now a large, you know, art facility.
Do you have a picture of the plaque, do we?
Oh, I do not, no.
You know, that really is very handsome.
Yes.
You should have a picture of that to show people.
Yes, no, they
you
did a
really should.
Brass did a beautiful job.
It's spectacular.
Yes, designing that plaque. But we encourage everybody to come out and vote and obtain a ballot and vote for your favorite building.
Amy, if you can get one of those forms to us, maybe we can Xerox some and have them available at the society.
Sure,
Because we did that 2 years ago.
Okay, sure, certainly.
Very good. Thank you, Amy.
You're welcome.
We take this opportunity to announce that there will be a new passing scene book for the holidays. The passing scene volume 16 is now being prepared and will be ready for distribution in November. As usual, it has 272 pages, over 300 photographs, including a Carsonia section, and it will be fully indexed. The selling price remains at $45, and pre-orders will be accepted in late summer.
Now, this is a very interesting aspect to the new book that's coming out. The Reading Times, many years ago, did a feature on Mondays during the winter. For 25 weeks, they saluted certain villages and hamlets in Berks County. They sent Leroy Gensler, the artist, there we are, the artist, out with Robert Bamford as a reporter. Robert Bamford was a farmer in Burn Township who died not all that long ago. He was 90 or 93, I believe. Anyhow, he went out, the two went out, and they interviewed the principal people in 25 towns and villages in Berks County. We're going to run that entire series. What makes this so valuable and significant, well, there are a couple of things. Number one, there are very few original Times newspapers around from the late 1930s. Most of what we see is on microfilm with scratches and everything else. And the fact that people are mentioned who will certainly ring a bell to many of the home viewers. Let me just read something that I have here that I've prepared. Again, we're excited to announce that the 60-page section will be featured that contains fun and facts and lots of illustrations you saw there a minute ago about 25 prominent Berks County villages. Each village and town sketch lists the prominent people who lived and worked there in the late 1930s. Actually, these 25, these 25, okay, don't answer that question. Okay, home viewer, you're on. Home viewer?
Yes.
You're on.
Yeah, I'd like to ask a question, if I may. Actually, it's two questions. One is, it was a Philadelphia Reading Railroad. And what happened there? Why did it become the Reading Railroad?
It went through a number of corporation changes that had a number of names over the years. Remember the Reading Lions, Reading Lions, L-I-N, that little bridge that crossed over from RAC had like a Lionel thing. It went through a number of name changes. And then in 1976, the PNR, the Reading Railroad, the Reading Lions, and so forth went out of business, and it came under the umbrella of Conrail, which eventually evolved into what we have today with the Norfolk.
Norfolk Southern.
There were a number of corporate changes, and when those major changes were made, there was a name change.
Philadelphia Reading Railroad at one time was the largest corporation in the world. Am I correct in that?
You're correct.
Yeah, and so when did it change to Reading, and for what reason?
What's that?
I believe it was. I mean, the Philadelphia and Reading Railroad is headquartered out of Philadelphia.
Yeah, it originally was supposed to be headquartered in Reading, which is why they had proposed a three-story outer station, which evolved into a two-story outer station with major headquarters in Philadelphia. The name was just changed when there was some major shakeups in the corporation. It's a rather long story. As a matter of fact, a fellow by the name of Herring wrote a book an inch thick explaining what you're just asking right now. And that book is available, I think, at the Historical Society if you're really curious about that transformation. When they said it was the largest corporation on the face of the earth, what they really meant was that not only did they run railroads, but they operated mines, they had steel plants, they were in charge of the Schuylkill, after 1890, in charge of the Schuylkill Canal, and all the canal boats that had been bought from the Pennsylvania Railroad in 1905 were later owned and operated by, quote, the Reading Company. So when they said the largest corporation, and they had a big port in Philadelphia, the port of Reading down in Philadelphia. They had steamships. They had all kinds of things that came under this general umbrella of the Reading Railroad. So it really was the largest corporation on the face of the earth. Just consider the mines that they owned, and they went far beyond Schuylkill County.
Well, okay. I wanted to ask one more question. When the president, gave that speech.
George F. Bear.
Yeah, and when the strikers and the people were out there in front of him, and he said something about, he rules or something like that through divine providence.
Divine providence.
Yeah, where did you get that speech at?
Where did he give it? I think that was given in Philadelphia, but I'm not sure. I read that many, many years ago. Right after that, there was a cartoon that appeared and had very wide circulation of a spider. And that spider was George F. Bear, and you see him sort of reaching out. He was vilified for that speech. I think he meant well, but it wasn't taken terribly well by the general public and the reporters at the time. There is a copy. We have a story in the news in our library that was prepared back in the 1960s by Colonel Wayne Holman. And that cartoon is in that article. It was one of those Sunday Reading Eagle features. The whole thing is explained there, and it shows that cartoon, and it talks about where he gave that speech and the reaction at the time.
And where was the port of Reading at?
Philadelphia.
Yeah, but where at?
Oh, I don't know. Philadelphia. You know, I was Google River to the water and turn left. I know that.
Okay,
I really can't say more than that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay.
All right, bye.
Let's do better. Each village and town sketch lists the prominent people who lived and worked there in the late 1930s, actually more specifically the winter of 1939, such as the butcher, the barber, the postmaster, the teacher, restaurant operator, craftsman and mechanics, the miller. You know, almost every village had a mill somewhere close by, store and hotel proprietors. Hundreds of people are included in this special section, which highlights the towns and villages of. And here's a list of the 25 that are included. So if any of you grew up or spent time years ago in any of these places, chances are you're going to recognize pictures of people and comments about Alleghenyville, Amityville, Bally, Burnville, Bechtel, Blandon, Centerport, both spellings, Fritzstown, Geigertown, Hook Church, Lenhartsville, Merckstown, Moton, Mooresville, Morgantown, Mount Pleasant, Pleasantville, New Jerusalem, Pine Forge, Pricetown, Stonersville, Stoutsburg, Stroustown, Virginville, and Westnersville, now more generally known as Stony Run. But that's the list of the 25 villages and towns that are going to be featured. That portion of the book will probably run 60 or more pages. It's a rather extensive part of the book, truthfully.
In all, there are 25 towns and villages discussed in detail. Viewers who grew up in any of the aforementioned places will probably find some familiar names and faces. More than likely, some viewers will find references to relatives and people they remember from childhood.
Right before the program started, Gloria was telling me about Stonersville, and she was mentioning some names, and she asked me, and it turns out that in the Stonersville article, there's material on one of our trustees and his son and the grandfather, all of whom had an affiliation with the historical society. Yes, we'll get to that shortly. Here we are some examples.
Here are some examples of the illustrations that appear. We'll present more next month.
Okay. Can we get that just a little bit brighter? If possible. Rambles and Berks, and we're looking at Pleasantville. There are principal people in Pleasantville. That gentleman in the upper right-hand corner, I knew very well. He was the general merchant and proprietor and postmaster of Pleasantville. By the way, some of you people, I'm sure, will remember that the post office in Pleasantville was not Pleasantville. How many recall what the post office was called in Pleasantville? See who gets it first. If you know what it is, give us a call. The school teacher, I believe, is listed there. It shows a little evangelical church in the lower left-hand corner. And it, what I find very interesting with the change of times, and by the way, the old Yoder home, Pleasantville was originally called Yoderstedtl, and the old Yoder home is right near the covered bridge at the end of the Ole Turnpike, and that's the old home, which is now for sale, I think, in the left-hand corner, in the left side, right against the edge of your screen. What I found very interesting was so many of these sketches, they salute the older people of the town. I'm wondering, would they do that today if they ran a similar series? And how many of those old folks smoked cigars? You'll see that in many of those sketches. Anyhow, that's Pleasantville. Next one is Millersburg. Yeah, Millersburg. Now, this surprised me. I didn't realize that Millersburg, the term Millersburg was still being used as late as 1939. As you had with Pleasantville, you had a village and the post office with two separate names. Millersburg had a post office name that will probably ring a bell for some people. Bethel. And what happened, sometimes they got rid of the village name and took the name of the post office, and in some cases it was just the opposite. But anyhow, there is Millersburg, or Bethel, and in the top row, the second over from the left, you see some strange illustrations. Those are supposed to be pipes of a pipe organ, because the Dieffenbach organs were made in Millersburg by the Dieffenbach family, who really got into diversification at an early point. They made organs, coffins, and covered bridges. That's diversification. And the Reformed Church is in the lower right-hand corner. I can tell you more about these things, but I can't really see them too well from where I'm sitting. So may I have the next one, please? Pine Forge. One thing that pleased me about this series of 25 is that it really got around all of Berks County. They went far north, they went as far west as Bethel, they were over at Huff Church, which is very close to the eastern border of Berks, and they were down at Geigertown. Now, I can't read it from here, but on that, it says that within the past year, they lost both the covered bridges in the village. Pine Forge had two wooden covered bridges at one time. And apparently, during the course of that past year, it would have been 1938-39, they lost their two wooden bridges. Consequently, people had to drive 5 miles out of their way to cross over. Anyhow, that's find forged. Notice that in that particular one, how many people you actually see represented. And what pleased me, Gensler, Leroy Gensler, whom I knew as a child, he worked with my dad years ago at the newspaper. He started with the Times, and in 1941 he joined the staff of the Reading Eagle Company. He did draw people well. When he drew somebody, you really recognized them, which makes these illustrations all the more valuable. Maybe have the next one, please. Blandon. The school teacher is there. The general merchant, the old fire company building in Blandon, which has since been replaced. The Blandon station on the left-hand side, right against the edge of your screen. I mean, the fellow's pictured there. They used to have a broom works there in Blandon, and he's pictured there as the fellow who made brooms. I don't know, is that the fellow on the right-hand side against the edge of the screen? Yeah, it looks that way to me. The next one, please. New Jerusalem. New Jerusalem is one of those towns or villages that if you blink, you've missed it. You know, you take the Pricetown Road to the T, and right at the head of the T is the New Jerusalem Hotel. And it talks about the old water trough outside the New Jerusalem Hotel. And it shows the two churches close by. There's one there shown, I believe, on the left, and I believe one on the right. Again, I can't see too well from where I'm seated. But it does show, but one thing I thought was interesting, it shows the upper left-hand corner, the village teacher. You know, in 1939, we still had a whole lot of one-room schoolhouses in Berks County. It wasn't until about 1941 that they began to close some of these buildings. And remember that the last one in Berks County was closed, the last public one-room schoolhouse was December the 23rd, 1961. So that when these sketches were prepared in 1939, there were a lot of one-room schoolhouses and you had the village teacher. Well, the village teacher there is that gentleman in the upper left-hand corner who has taught 45 terms. And that little boy who is mentioned, and his little boy probably still is around somewhere, because he'd be a little bit older than I am, he's the third generation in his family having been taught by that teacher who's there with the textbook in his hand. That's New Jerusalem, and I believe that in the top row, second from the right, is the New Jerusalem Hotel, I think. The next picture, please. Centerport. Just to give you a little bit of an idea of what's involved with this. No, wait a minute here. Do we have Stonersville? Let's go to the next one, please. Is Stonersville there? Yeah. Is that the last one? Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, just to give you an idea about some of the things that are in here. This I found very interesting. In the write-up itself, I'm not going to read the whole thing, just give you a little bit of a taste of what the writing is like. That Robert Bamford, as I said, was a farmer from Burn Township who lies buried in Epper's Church. He died at the age, I believe, of 93, and he was born the same year as my father, 1904. Still catch bobcats and huge snappers near Stonersville, near the Daniel Boone home. Of course, we had a fox in the yard last night, so.
Yeah.
If Daniel Boone were to come back to his native heath, he would find a large group of his acquaintances stuffed. Boone, most famous of American pioneers and backwoodsmen, to the opinion of the Encyclopedia Britannica, was born in the lower part of Exeter Township near Stonersville, which stretches along the Boyertown Pike 4 miles from Reading. The pioneer would find his acquaintances posed in the ice cream parlor of Lawrence Geiger, postmaster at Stonersville. The Stonersville post office continued in operation until the 1960s when the postmaster died and they closed the office at Stonersville. Boone did not get along well with men. That's a revelation. From the time he left Exeter as a boy, he was always moving away from them. I guess he means humanity, I'm not sure. He did not have the kind of shrewdness that was needed to deal with them. Though they credited him with opening the state of Kentucky, their legal tricks and taxes took him all the lands from him. When he died at 86 in the prairies west of the Mississippi, having cleared a route for millions, old Dan Boone was penniless. Truly, the companions of this man were the creatures of the wilderness, snarling bobcats. It is these which are stuffed and posed in Geiger's ice cream parlor. Over the post office window, there is a snarling wildcat. Beside him is a raccoon and nearby a possum. Then it catches on by many Geiger families. It talks about the Geigers. Gloria, where's that one portion about the... about the attorney and his... Well, we don't take too much time.
Yeah.
It says, the village took its title from George Stoner, who came there as a hotel man in 1847. The hotel then was called the Compass. You know, that old hotel in Stonersville, what date is on there, is actually built in two parts, and the part on the right, the eastern part, is very, very old compared to the addition. Many drovers stopped there. Stoner had a 40-acre pasture for their stock. That's interesting. And later built the brick stable to the west, which has stood empty for years. Later, Victor Goodhart was Stonersville landlord and storekeeper. Yeah, as was the true of many, many places, you had the post office, the store, and the hotel within the same building. Let's see, once when Victor was 15, one of the school directors came into the store inquiring for the neighborhood's auctioneer. He had to put new floors in two of the houses and wanted to sell the old planks. Very brashly, Victor said, "I'll do that for a quarter," and so forth. Anyhow, that gives you a general idea of the type of writing that that is included with these historical sketches. Some of you will remember Mayor Bamford in the city of Reading. Well, Bob was his brother, was Mayor Bamford's brother. And really very, very interesting material. Gloria?
Steinberg left the Society's executive director, was a leading force in the planning and execution of a truly outstanding event that took place this past Saturday, an evening that will long be remembered. Time?
Well, Gloria, thank you. That was those very kind words, but I can tell you that that evening would not have come off were it not for the staff of the Historical Society of Berks County. I am very blessed, very fortunate man to have the staff that I do. We did have a wonderful evening on Saturday night. It was entitled All Aboard, Celebrating the 175th Anniversary of the Reading Railroad. And as is every year, the Historical Society tries to have one major fundraising event. But actually, more, as it turns out, they generally turn out to be more of friend-raising events.
That's true, absolutely.
And it really was a wonderful evening. We decided, we were fortunate in that about a year ago when we were doing the Three Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour, which this year will be called the Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour because we have that much, we one of the properties on the tour was a property by the name of Five Springs Farm owned by David and Liz Goldfarb. And they were gracious enough to open their home to the people of Reading for that tour. But after that, they said, "Fine." They said, "If you and the Historical Society would ever like to have a fundraising event, we would be more than happy to host it here at our farm." And naturally, I took them up on that kind and gracious offer. But we started organizing this, and Janice Longlot, our publicity coordinator, and I worked on this project. In addition, we worked with the rest of the staff to put this together, and we have some pictures of the event, and that's one of the pictures that shows the portion of the group, a small portion. We had approximately 200 guests attending this function, and it was an ox and a pig roast, and the catering was done by Bravo Catering, and they did just a wonderful, wonderful job. But it really was an evening of celebration, on many fronts. The first in that, the historical legacy that we share here in Berks County that we have so every reason to be very, very proud of. Very few communities share the historical legacy we do. And in this particular case, it was the legacy of the company that we were honoring that night, the 175th anniversary of the Reading Railroad. When you look at that that company and the way they, the expeditious way they transported coal from the coal regions of Pennsylvania to the industry in Philadelphia, they were a company that hastened the Industrial Revolution. When you look at how they changed the modes of transportation we take so much for granted today, they were a forerunner in that. Early forms of communication.
Sorry, may I interrupt you one minute? That last picture that we saw, in the barn, they had an exhibit of railroad memorabilia,
right.
Much of which was owned and lent to us by Ben Bernhardt. And Joshua Blay, our curator, and Ben set up that very interesting exhibit in the barn. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. It was like you said, it was just celebrating that type of thing. Also celebrating the, you know, the progress that the historical society is making. When you look at the expanding outreach programs we provide the citizens of Berks County, when you look at the beautiful restoration work that we've done on the Hendel House, which we make available for the people of Reading to see and visit on a monthly basis, or when you look at the, you know, soon to be Johnson Library. Like I said, these are things that, like I said, bring something to the community that, you know, give them a foundation, a sense of identity. So it was that, but it was also, you know, again, as I said, friend raising too. And so we were celebrating the old friends that have been with us for so many years and have helped us continue to fulfill our mission at the Historical Society, or the new friends, like the Goldfarbs, like the people that visited them, came down for the evening from New York. I didn't mention the Goldfarbs live in Staten Island, New York, and they think enough of this community that they purchased that farm and restored it and had it put on the National Register. This is the group that was assembled that night. Again, about 200 people, right at 200 people came as the guests. It was just a wonderful evening. Bravo Catering did the catering. The food was delicious. When we were setting up this event, they show another inside shot of the tent, and that was the event staging was done by Dave Reppert from Boscov's. They did all the decorations and did just a magnificent job.
And we should mention that in spite of the warm day, it really was not uncomfortable in the tent that night, and there were virtually no bugs.
No, I didn't have any, notice any bugs.
I just remember it astonishing to me.
Yeah. We could have used about two or three more fans, though, but it was very, very pleasant.
By the way, can we go back to, there was something that you didn't comment upon.
Yeah, we want to, and we were talking about something. Back up two shots.
If that's possible.
Keep going.
it was the one.
Was Senator okay?
Yes.
Well, that's right. Again, friend raising. And here's a man that's done so much for Berks County. His leadership has brought so much into the county and has, you know, really set us in good stead. But he's a very good friend of the Historical Society. He was there delivering a proclamation honoring this event. Honoring the 175th anniversary of the Reading Railroad and this event. And, you know, it's always great to have the Senator around, you know, he's just a really good friend, and that's what this was all about, the friend-raising that we do there. And also the, you know, other friends, the new friends that we have that have helped the Historical Society in so many ways. In particular, again, Norfolk Southern providing the underwriting for this exhibit, but also for this evening, to help this evening come off, we had as our train master sponsor for the evening, which was our signature sponsor, Penske Truck Leasing. They were the signature sponsor for this event. And then we had a railroad can't run without engineers, so we had a number of engineer sponsors. And I'd like to read them off because, like I said, these people are the people that help us fulfill the mission of the Historical Society to preserve and promote the legacy of Berks County and make it available to all the citizens. With that in mind, I would like to thank F.M. Brown & Son, Fulton Bank, M&T Bank, C.B. Berks Village, Richard Levengood Architects is also doing the Henry Johnson Library, Riverfront Federal Credit Union, the Highlands of Wyomissing, Vist Financial and Insurance, Weidenhammer, as well as William G. Tuck and Associates. All those people help us do what we do at the Historical Society, and again, an evening like this, just wouldn't happen without it. And you know what I noticed a lot, George, is people were coming just saying, just how pleasant the evening was. It wasn't, you know, you go to a lot of places, and it's true, this was a fundraising event. Make no bones about it. But, you know, like I said, so many times you feel, in a lot of situations, you feel like you're being put upon. This was just a pleasant party that, you know, brought friends together just for a warm, a wonderful evening of convivial fun.
Yeah, this was spectacular. That was unbelievable.
Yeah, that was unique desserts. Ann Louise Reinert over at Unique Desserts. She always does an incredible job with the cakes. That's a cake, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah.
I mean, it's
the trains going into the tunnel.
The trains going in the tunnel.
That was just unbelievable.
And she took our logo. I don't know if you saw prior on the one of those other shots where it showed the inside of the tent washed. They put that the logo shot. That's the logo on the cake. And just a wonderful, wonderful evening.
The cake was spectacular. Oh. It was like a lemon cake with a...
That's right. White vanilla cake with a... with a lemon lacing on the inside for the, you know, for the second layer, and then a white buttercream frosting. Yeah, it was great. There were some leftovers that went to the Historical Society, I guess, on Tuesday when we reopened. I was going for the last 2 days. I doubt that there will be any left by the time I get there.
There was nothing.
There was nothing. I think that's all right. You guys deserve it. Anyway, that was the fundraiser. We'll be doing one next year. And like I said, as when you're a member of the Historical Society, you get informed, and we send out notices that we're having these events. And so, you know, like I said, that's another good reason for being a member of the Historical Society, is that you get to, you know, get to know what's going on, and take part in events like this.
There's a home viewer sign, and maybe you want to say a few words about the four senses, or did you cover
that? Oh, yeah, let me say
okay,
something. Take the home viewer first?
Take the home viewer first. Yes, home viewer.
Hi, George.
Yes.
This is Chile Stone Foods.
Yes.
I remember talking to you a while ago about Stinky Gordon.
About whom?
Stinky Gordon Band.
Oh, yes.
Yes, what was the theater that they played at? I cannot remember that.
You have me.
You don't remember the theater? They had the hot, it got so hot in there the chocolate melted.
Sounds interesting.
Yes, it does.
Yes, do you remember Stinky Gordon, though?
The name rings a bell.
Yes, and they had a rusty trombone player. And his name was Gary Sanchez. Do you remember him at all?
No.
Oh, what about Ronnie?
I think he was pulling our leg.
I believe he
was.
Yeah,
I think so, too. Okay, Sam, give us a little bit about the Four Centuries.
Well, the Four Centuries Tour, again, we changed the name from Three Centuries in Berks to Four Centuries in Berks because this year we have a home that was built in the 21st century. And, again, we like to take in all the architecture of Berks County throughout its, you know, from its existence, from its inception. And so this year's the Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. It's being held the first Saturday in October. That's going to be October 4th, 2008. It'll be held from 9 o'clock in the morning till 4 o'clock. Ticket prices are $22 per ticket. They can be purchased at the Historical Society and a number of other locations. We haven't finalized those locations yet, but we'll be telling you about them next month and in September. But it's going to be a beautiful tour. We've got Charming Forge. We have the boarding house at Charming Forge, Christ Lutheran Church, a number of the Topahawken Settlement, and just some beautiful, beautiful properties on this tour. And it looks like it's stacking up to be one of a kind. I've always said before, this is the type of tour that, you know, I describe it as, you know, you're driving around Berks County and you see one of these lovely properties and say, boy, I'd love to see the inside of that place. This tour gives you that opportunity. You can drive at your own pace. You can take the houses in the order of your choosing, or you can go on. We're also going to do a bus this year. That George, you're going to be the tour director on that bus. And that bus, I believe this year, we're going to have a slight increase because of the gas prices on that. That bus is going to be $50, but then you don't have to spend your money on gas. You have George giving you the tour and leave the driving to us. So it's going to be just a great tour again, Saturday, October 4th, 2008. And it's going to be at the Marion Township and the Borough of Wilmingstorf.
Yes, Western Berks is a very interesting part of the county, a very historical part of the county. interwoven by the Union Canal.
Well, you know, it's remarkable because generally we have always looked at when we do the three centuries of Berks Historic Property Tour, we generally pick out two to three different townships to, you know, to showcase, you know, the properties, because that's what you need to put, say, generally we have 10 to 12, 9 to 12 different properties on this. This year, we had one township and the borough of Wilmersdorf, and actually we had more homes than, you know, we could
possibly
even
use.
Yeah, possibly use. Mm-hmm. It was very remarkable. I mean, it really has beautiful, beautiful.
What's that date again, Sam?
Saturday, October 4th.
Saturday, October 4th. And tickets are available?
Tickets are available at the Historical Society. They will also be available at Green Valley Nursery. We know that for sure. Eston Shades. Mm-hmm. And there are two or three other ones that we have as well. I don't have them at the top of my head right now. I have to talk to Janet about that.
And you should mention that as part of this tour, they receive a very handsome booklet with a lot of history in it. I mean, the booklet itself is a valuable piece of work.
It is. Generally, it's 32 pages, four colors, designed by Reese Advertising. It's a beautiful piece. It is a keeper.
It's a keeper.
It is a keeper.
It's absolutely a keeper. No question.
Sure is.
I believe we have time for some slides. Is that number 33? That's not number 33. Okay, let's wing it. That's the old State House at 5th and 10th. Pauline's Soups would be on the right-hand side of the screen. We're looking at three doors that entered from North 5th Street. That building burned in was built in 1793, because when George Washington came to Berks County October the 1st, 1794, that building was standing, and they had the Masonic Order meeting on the second floor on the right-hand side. That building was set ablaze by a fire that started in the Stichter's Hardware Store next door. Many of us remember Stichter's Hardware Store. Of course, there's a Stichter's Hardware Store building yet, actually the third one on that site. But that's the old State House. As a matter of fact, when you walk up North 5th Street, if you look sort of in the position, now there are like office buildings, office fronts all along 5th Street, but if you look about the center, you'll see that old date stone of, it says, State House 1793. You notice that it's cracked. And that crack came from the fire, the spectacular blaze of 1872, which destroyed that building. However, the foundation is still there, and so is the basement. Some of us went through that. You were there that time. Went through that basement. Unfortunately, you know, people oftentimes write to the Historical Society saying that I'm interested in the Hessians who spent time in Berks County and who were quartered up in Hessian, what we call Hessian camp today. What records do you have of the Hessians who were quartered here in the Reading area? And the answer is, my good friends, those records were in the attic of that building that burned in 1872, so that we don't have a whole lot left of those records. Now, what happened, later on, they rented portions of that out for commercial purposes, but they still kept some of the old county records in that attic. I don't know why they were kept there, but they were. And whatever was there was lost in the fire of 1872. So what the building that you see on that site today has exactly the same dimensions, but it was rebuilt. Aha, there we are. It says, that was a card that was sent out. It says, terrible destruction of property, the fire fiend. Estimated cost, $250,000 in 1872.
Wow.
That's a bundle of change. And it said, what's that bottom line? Tuesday morning, January 16th, 1872. Old landmarks gone. So is the apostrophe. But anyhow. That is, I think I see Trinity in the background there. The building would be on the left-hand side. Ebner's Hotel is there in the middle of your screen. Now, Ebner's Hotel, he was one of those old militia leaders, you know, about a militia. A lot of old military men used to meet there and do whatever old military men used to do, which I'm sure involves some amber fluid. But that building was destroyed. Colonel Ebner was a well-known person in the Reading area many years ago. Needless to say, his business was destroyed. Now, on that site today, wasn't there a place where they sold electrical appliances or something? It was Reading Chandelier Works was later built there. I don't know what's there today. But there's a building there today that has taken its place. Stickler's Hardware would be that wonderful building on the right-hand side. Yes. I find this absolutely extraordinary that the slides that we're looking at have no bearing whatever to the key that I have lying before me. Let me see. We're on Penn Street. And we're in the 500 block because there in the middle of the picture, you see the Cohen brothers' big clock that used to stand right along the edge of the sidewalk between 5th and 6th on the south side. Notice those very interesting trolleys. There's a wonderful picture that exists that shows 7 trolleys in a row all lined up on Penn Street. But wouldn't it be wonderful to take a long ride through the city streets today in an open trolley car like that.
Nice.
Absolutely fascinating. Cohen's jewelry store, which had the biggest inventory of jewelry in the city of Reading and in Berks County. As a matter of fact, Cohen's daughter, who's now deceased, used to live in Glen Olley Farms in Exeter Township. She was very proud of her dad's store. That white building that you see behind the clock, that was Cohen's jewelry store. I guess on that site today would be one of the old 5 and 10 cent store buildings, whatever it's being used for today. But that's the Penn Street scene. So look at that.
Yeah, that's amazing. That's about 1920s, 1918.
A little earlier.
1918,
1919?
Straw boaters.
A little earlier.
Really?
Notice the Farr Shoe Store building. There, near the top of the screen, almost dead center. Mm-hmm. Amy, Tad Kastner, and I were in that building the last day that it survived on Earth.
Yeah.
Really?
And we took some pictures. That was a very, very interesting tour.
Yeah.
Then we discovered that indeed that was the 1761 building. There was no question about that, in spite of the fact that certain people swore that there was nothing whatever left of that 1761 building.
Yep.
They were dead wrong. Yeah. And I won't mention any reporter's name because I'm not that kind of a guy. But he was dead wrong. He wrote a big editorial. There's nothing left. Not a thing. I only wish he would have been with us. Anyhow, there we are, Penn Street, looking to the corner of 5th and Penn. Isn't that an amazing picture?
Yeah,
and
that's a great
the
picture.
The hotel is on the opposite corner there.
Yeah, there you see on the opposite corner at 5th and Penn on the southeast corner would be the Mansion House Hotel, Berks County's finest hotel, without a doubt, enlarged in 1893 by Mr. Humboldt.
And Teddy Roosevelt, so from
1912. He addressed 50,000 people without a microphone. That's what I call a man.
Yeah.
I remember President Clinton, he was running with Horace, and he used a microphone. Remember that? During that election back in the 90s? Well, Teddy Roosevelt stopped at Allentown. And on the way to Allentown, he made a surprise stop at the rolling mill at Blandon. That was the only president ever to visit Blandon.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And there's no plaque there to commemorate that event, but
I wonder if my grandfather was there.
Really?
Yeah, well, that's where my family's from, Blandon.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yes, we read that Blandon story.
I do want to.
Okay. We're in Tennessee. Isn't that a wonderful picture? I know the date of that, 1898. That was taken in 1898. It would have been taken from the second floor window of Pomeroy's, except that Pomeroy's wasn't there in 1898. But had it been there, that would have been the camera position. We're looking over to the north side. There we see the Stichter building. And if you look down almost against the upper left-hand side of the edge of the screen, you're seeing Redding's first mansion. The Central House, the Grand Central Hotel. They tore that down to make way for the Acme. So that's your point of reference there. And you see the building over here, the old Opera House, and on the right-hand side would be about where the Crystal Restaurant had been.
Yeah.
For your orientation. Okay. This is absolutely fascinating. Now, these slides are totally unfamiliar to me. It was a skip that I had. But anyhow, we're at the corner of 6th and Penn. There we see the Pennsylvania House or the Hotel Penn, latterly the Michener Hotel. In the 1950s, they tore away the top three stories because they were condemned. And what you have there is the building that you have at 6th and Penn, running back to 6th and Port. That would be that building. The first telephone exchange in the city of Reading, 1876, was in the top floor of that building. And over there we see the Sellers building on the corner, where the first off-the-rack suits were made available in the city of Reading. That was a big deal.
Wow,
you could go in there and get a suit right off the rack. And notice the portico. At one time you could go from 6th to the... Aha! Well, it's that time again, folks. Tell your friends about our program, which is on live the first Wednesday of each month at 7. Thanks to the program participants, Amy Walsh Johnson, Simon Bertlett, Gloria Jean, and myself, your host. Look for us next month, first Wednesday. Thanks for watching. So long.
Don't forget to go to the music.
Go ahead. Oh, sorry about that.
On BCTV is supported in part by the Highlands at Wyomissing.